Hello everyone, I am Swati and on behalf of my organization, the Democratic Students Federation, I welcome you all to this public meeting. Today is an important day as it marks the 102nd death anniversary of Comrade Rosa Luxemburg, and so we have organized this meeting to revisit Rosa and her revolutionary ideas today. Today's meeting, revisiting Rosa Luxemburg in the times of fascism, will be addressed by Professor Ruchira Sen, who teaches at Global Jindan University, and she's also been our very old comrade. But before connecting with her, I would like to share some lines with you all. As Rosa has written, bourgeois society stands at the crossroad, either transition to socialism or regression to barbarism. These words echo down the ages, both as a prophecy and a challenge today. These were written over 100 years ago by Rosa Luxemburg, a middle-aged woman in freezing German jail cell, a woman who has left an unforgettable mark in history. She was one of the most important thinkers and leaders of 20th century, and her calls for freedom, socialism, and democracy scandalized people at the time, both from the left and the right. She was a woman who truly lived an extraordinary life, especially for a woman of her time. She was a radical, she was revolutionary, she was Polish, a Jewish woman, an immigrant, a political refugee, and she was disabled, and also she was a socialist woman. These were so many strikes against her name that should have kept her on the margins, that should have shut her down, but she was never shied away from speaking up her mind, especially to the people who were considered her social superiors. So who was this woman whose passion for revolution and justice sent shockwaves throughout the German society, whose thoughts continue to influence us and inspire millions of people like us around the world? How is she relevant in these times of fascism, and what is the significance of revisiting her ideas today? To answer all these questions and many more today, we have Professor Ruchira Sen with us. Just to let you all know, this meeting will be in two parts. In the first part, she'll be addressing us, and the second part will be sort of an interactive session with her where you can ask your questions. And also, I would like to add that you can place all your questions and anything related to that which you want her to, you know, elaborate on in the comment section, which later will be addressed by Professor Ruchira at the end of the meeting. Now, without taking any more time, I would like to call Professor Ruchira Sen to address us all. Professor Ruchira.
Hello, everybody. Today, you know, the 102nd death anniversary of Rosa Luxemburg, one seeks to, you know, ask the question, why are we revisiting Luxemburg? Why are we having this talk today, right? One of the major reasons is that there are a lot of, you know, formulaic ideas of radicalism. There are notions that, you know, how do you become a radical? How do you critique power? How do you speak truth to power? And there are very many formulae about how to do it. Luxemburg actually defies all of those formulae. She's a very fiercely independent figure. She had a searing critique of capitalism, but she also refused to identify with radicalism of her times, of the 20th century, and the late 19th century as well. For according to Luxemburg, she understood capitalism to be overcome only through a participatory and a democratic process involving the majority of the oppressed. Now, what does that mean, right? You should have, in the 20th century, what is the kind of critique to capitalism that you encounter? Mostly, if you can think about the most, you know, frequent critique is obviously Bolshevism, right? And Rosa Luxemburg critiqued Bolshevism. She believed that this cannot be the only kind of socialism. So That's a departure, right? It's also a departure from electoral politics. She was not into bourgeois democracy or the idea of participating in bourgeois democracy, but she was very much into radical democracy, in the or radical participative democracy. The idea that people who are marginalized by capitalism would be able to rise up against it, and there would, you know, organization would not be a very top-down kind of organization. Rather, organization would involve diverse voices across different platforms. And in this regard, I mean, that is actually why Rosa Luxemburg has become more relevant in the 21st century than, you know, many people bothered about her in the 20th century and so on. Mostly because she's anticipating many of these 21st century struggles against capitalism. The women's march against the Trumpist regime, for example, this Occupy protests, the student protests, the anti-rape agitation in 2013. Today's farmer struggles are all the JNU students movement. These are all movements that Luxembourg would be very sympathetic to. You know, her politics would be very sympathetic to movements like this, which makes her a very, a figure that was way before her time. It's almost as if she anticipated the 21st century struggle against fascism and capitalism in the 20th century itself. So that's basically what makes Luxembourg special. Okay. So, one of the major, I think, you know, for someone who has been involved in student activism, one of the major reasons why I think Luxembourg really out is because for Luxembourg, agitation and standing up against power is about what it means to become truly human, about achieving human potential. And that's actually quite an interesting idea, because that draws her closer to Marx. You know, a lot of times, I mean, I'm sure you all feel this with the JNU movement often, where you get the idea of sacrifice. You know, you're always being told that you have to sacrifice for the movement. You're always being told you have to, you know, not pay a lot of attention to your individual aspirations, but rather place collective aspirations over individual aspirations. Rosa Luxemburg did not really believe in that, which is quite interesting. So you would start to think that, oh, does this make her a bourgeois figure? No, right? But it makes her a uniquely feminist figure, and I'll come to that. This is a line from Rosa Luxemburg's letter to Leo Jogiches. He was her partner. And she wrote, I mean, according to Peter Hudis, these lines really define who Luxembourg was. She says, "I feel in a word the need as," Ladisha Hein is a friend of hers from, the University of Zurich, where she did her PhD. And she said, "I feel the need to say something great. I feel within me a maturing, a completely new and original form which dispenses with the usual formula and patterns and breaks them down. I feel with utter certainty that something is there, that something will be born." And that is what is, you know, because she believes that her politics and her way of articulating herself, her theory, is uniquely different from anything that existed in the 20th century at that time. And it's something to, you know, say to someone, you know, to say that I am different from everyone else around me. It almost seems it seems a rather self-obsessive thing to say, in a way, but it is not that, right? It is a very honest thing to say. And she says this to Leo Jogiches. Leo Jogiches was, as I said, her partner. Now, Rosa's relationship with Leo Jogiches is actually very interesting. And, you know, there are many, many letters that she wrote to him from 1844 to the early days, early 20th century, where you know, Leo very strongly believed that he wants to sacrifice himself for the revolution. He believed that the revolution comes first and he comes second, right? So he was very sparing of himself, would never give much weight to his individual aspirations. But Rosa was different. Rosa, in her letter, talked about her demands for affection. She was quite a demanding partner in that way. But she also made it clear that she saw a life for the two of them where they would live together. And while they would definitely, you know, engage in revolutionary politics and participate in the struggle against capitalism and fascism, at that time as well, that they would have a life of struggle. It was not, I mean, you know, when we talk about Rosa Luxemburg and today's her death anniversary, we talk about her death. But actually what is inspiring about Rosa is her life. You know, she wanted to live for the revolution, not to die for the revolution. And by living, she meant living a truly authentic life. You know, to be with her partner, she wanted to have children. She was very categorical about that. You know, you don't get the idea that she would sacrifice herself and sacrifice her desire for a family on the altar of the revolution, right? You don't see that. It's a very human need to have children, and she's very open about that. So she says she wants to have children. She says she wants to go on walks and at the same time fight for the revolution. And that is actually a very feminist way of looking at revolutionary politics, because, you know, this is a world before personal is political. Rosa Luxemburg wanted to lead a life which is governed by her politics. And that life would be a truly authentic life, and in a way closer to what Marx saw for revolutionary politics. You know, many people think that socialism is not about the individual, that socialism is about collectives. You know, individual comes later, collective comes first, individual is only a consequence of society. But actually, that's not true. Marx and German ideology makes it very clear that the purpose of socialism is to create a complete human being. In capitalism, there is specialization. Human beings only become professors or scholars or fishermen or factory workers or farmers. And a farmer does not have a chance to read critical philosophy, right? A professor does not have the chance to get her hands dirty and learn how to make a really nice dress or learn how to make a really nice cake for her son. I don't know. You know. So, you know, for Marx, Marx talked about socialism as something that would enable you to fish in the morning, to hunt in the afternoon, and to criticize or to discuss philosophy in the evening, right? And Rosa Luxemburg is very much within that line of, you know, thinking with regard to how she wants to do her politics. She wants a family, she wants a life, she wants to go on walks, she wants time to think and come up with theories, and at the same time she wants to organize and campaign and do the usual political activity. So, you know, Rosa Luxemburg is many things. What I love about the poster that was designed for this talk is that it says straight out that Rosa Luxemburg is an economist. And that's important to say, because the economics world is a heavily male-dominated world, and often there isn't enough space for female voices and female economist voices, which, you know, and Rosa Luxemburg's economics is as revolutionary as her politics and needs to be salvaged and relooked at. And that is a space that still has not been fully explored. Okay, so you know, when you usually talk about Rosa Luxemburg, you're talking about the Second Internationale, which happened between 1889 and 1916. What do you see about this poster? Most of them are men, as you will notice, and there are two women there at the extreme right. If you can see, you have Clara Zetkin, and right in the middle, in a big hat, that's Rosa Luxemburg, right? And Second Internationale started to fall apart in 1916. It's an international organization of workers, and it does not hold out. There's a very famous reason why it collapses. And that's mostly because of the tussle between the goals of reformism and revolution or radicalism. Reformism comes from Bernstein, Carl Bernstein. And his idea was that, you know what, 1916, right? The world is at war. 1914 onwards, world is at war, First World War. Bernstein believed that capitalism is here to stay, that capitalism is stable and it's not going anywhere. There is not much chance of a socialist revolution coming. So how do workers create a better space for themselves? Bernstein felt that workers can create a better space for themselves through trade unionization mostly, and through demanding their benefits from the state. And he believed that the workers need to go to war and fight for their nations, their respective nation states, in order to, you know, get some goodwill and fight for better rights for themselves. So, you know, it's a very trade unionist, reformist attitude towards capitalism. Lenin and Rosa Luxemburg were very against this idea. Firstly, they said that capitalism is not a stable system. It is very unlikely that capitalism will last, that there are lots, you know, like Marx used to say that every system has within it the seeds of its own destruction. Lenin and Luxembourg believed very strongly that capitalism has within itself the seeds of its own destruction. And they believed that capitalism could be overthrown or that it would fall apart on its own, you know. So they were very against the idea of supporting the war. They were anti the First World War. And they believed that workers should not go to war against one another for the sake of their bourgeois leaders or their czarist leaders, you know, because you can't turn a gun on your comrade, essentially. Because, you know, if the workers of the world are in internationally, there's an international brotherhood of work of the working class, then you cannot kill your own brother or your own sister, right? And, you know, back in the day, I mean, if you don't go to war for your country, you can be arrested and you go to jail. And Rosa Luxemburg, this is a very nice photograph. This is Clara Zetkin and Rosa Luxemburg in 1910. And Rosa Luxemburg was very busy organizing workers against the war. You know, a very prominent voice of the anti-war agitation. She was, in the language of the Vietnam War, which came many years later, a conscientious objector. And while she was objecting to the war, along organizing around a very important day, which is the International Working Women's Day, right? And particularly, you know, who does the war hurt the most? Really, women, right? Because the burden of reproducing society falls on the backs of women. Schools close, so there is the burden of educating children, of watching your children go to war and die, you know. Someone who you raise with, you know, your own labor, when that person dies, then, you know, that is your labor going to waste for a war that is not yours, you know, and that has very little to do with you. So, and at the same time, there is the burden of just keeping the economy running. So women are mostly among the biggest losers of war. They also tend to face the largest kind of violence when, you know, when they face attack from an enemy, because the idea of, you know, rape is often used as a weapon of war, essentially, as it was in the Hathras case as well. So, again, you know, that's another very important reason why women would object to the war and why Rosa Luxemburg organized particularly women against the war. And given that Rosa Luxemburg mobilized women against the war, she had to go to jail. You know, she was sent to prison. When she went to prison, then she started to think about Vladimir Ilyich Lenin and his work in the Russian Revolution. But before that, let's just talk a little bit about, you know, Luxembourg and Lenin, who both felt that capitalism is destabilizing, but they have different reasons why they think so, right? Lenin says that, look, capitalism might be stabilized. It might be stabilized by monopoly capital, by finance capital. There is a tendency for capitalism to concentrate. Competition will, you know, because according to Marx, competition is what leads to crisis. Lenin believed that competition will eventually go down. You know, there is a tendency for monopolies. So, however, the imperialist chain of monopolies has weaknesses, and he felt that Tsarist Russia was the weakest link in the imperialist chain. So he thought that you can lead a very disciplined movement by a vanguard of revolutionaries, and then you can overthrow the government. And that is exactly what he went on to do in the October Revolution. Luxembourg, on the other hand, felt that, you know, capitalism is inherently unstable. It is so unstable that it will just collapse on its own. And that's because, and then she developed her own theory in her book, The Accumulation of Capital. She says that as capitalist accumulation is occurring, there is no more of a need to invest. You know, capitalism is a demand-constrained system. And then capitalists run into low expectations of profitability. So capitalism has a tendency to collapse on its own anyway. So it's not necessary that you need to, you know, actively create a vanguard and overthrow it. Rather, you can be involved in people's movements, people's struggles, you know, protest against incursions of capitalism, protest against colonization, and so on. When Luxembourg goes to prison, as she did for, you know, organizing women workers around the International Working Women's Day, she became concerned about the less democratic aspects of the Bolshevik organization. She was obviously thrilled that, you know, there is a Soviet socialist government in the USSR, and the USSR has been formed. But then she was very concerned that there isn't much democratic engagement within the party. She said that the Central Committee or your Politburo is the only thinking element, and every other element of the party is just limbs. You know, thinking like head being the thinking element, and the rest are just the limbs, the hands and the legs. And Luxembourg believed that you cannot separate thought from execution or from doing. And she said that, look, workers are not being able to articulate their own political activity. Rather, there is a vanguard of intellectuals and, you know, organizers telling them what to do. And this is, you know, this is very inimical to the working class and to their participation in the in politics. And it actually makes the working class into an oppressed class. So she was very against, you know, she wrote her pamphlet, The Russian Revolution, Leninism or Marxism, to critique this particular aspect of Bolshevik organization. And this is where she said that true freedom is for the one who thinks differently. She says Lenin's concern is not so much to make the activity of the party more fruitful as to control the party, to narrow the movement rather than to develop it, to bind rather than to unify it. And thereby, you know, she looks at this idea of discipline as a way of control. And she was very against the idea of Politburo's control over political activity. And this is very different from bourgeois freedom. You know, one would think that here is a woman who believes in individual freedoms, who believes in freedom. You know, this freedom, the use of freedom by Luxembourg, is very different from the use of freedom in the USA, right? You know, you must have often heard the land of the free and the home of the brave. That freedom is a different kind of freedom. It means that your peasant is freed from the land because corporates have taken over the land. It means that we are freed from knowledge because corporates have come and taken over all ways of having knowledge, and now we have to pay a sum of money to use a particular technology, as in the case of the COVID vaccine, right? Freedom in capitalism is the freedom from the means of production, and that's why the freedom to enter into labor contracts, right? How do you free a housewife from her feudal obligations? By pushing her to work in garments factories or domestic work. But that's not how Luxembourg sees freedom. To Luxembourg, freedom is the freedom of the Women's March, marching against Trump, the freedom of JNU students to speak truth to power in the Modi era, the freedom of our comrade Omar Khalid, the freedom of Kanhaiya Kumar. You know, for Rosa Luxemburg, freedom is more about Azadi, as you all know it, right? And that's very different from the mainstream notions of freedom. Okay. The accumulation of capital. Accumulation of capital, of course, is very important to talk about. And that's for two reasons. First of all, it is, you know, it is Rosa Luxemburg's main work in economics, and it's divided into two parts. The first is, of course, to say that capitalism is unstable. And she shows that by looking at Marx's models of expanded reproduction. And she says that, you know, in Marx, under competition or competitive capitalism, capitalists are always competing with one another. They exploit labor. They try to substitute labor by machinery and end up cheapening the in terms of value their product. And that's why there is a tendency towards products becoming cheaper and cheaper in Marx. Rosa Luxemburg, however, says that, look, in Marx, you have constant reiterations of labor and capital, and the production cycle just keeps happening. But what is making this wheel turn? You know, why is this production circuit happening? And in fact, according to Rosa, the production circuit should not happen, because at some point, you know, what's happening is there is enough demand to replace the capital. There is enough demand to replace the labor. But each time labor keeps producing a surplus value, and Luxembourg felt that there isn't enough demand to replace the surplus value. And that actually anticipates an argument which was made several years later by Keynes and Kaleski. I think at some point, I think Joan Robinson argues that Luxembourg understood the relationship between savings and investment better than any pre-Keynesian. However, her writings in economics are still considered controversial. Joan Robinson, of course, says that her model is wrong, which is correct. Rosa Luxemburg's model has very many deterministic assumptions. So the model that she used is obviously incorrect. But the more influential critique is that she is an underconsumptionist. She said that capitalism will produce a lot of goods that nobody will buy. But that's not true. Ricardo Bellafiore, here's a picture of him, and if you want to read his work, go ahead. To those who are interested, I can, you know, give you guys a nice reading list on Rosa Luxemburg if you want. Well, to the extent that one can access these things. But anyway, Ricardo Bellafiore shows that this is not what Luxemburg is thinking. He says that Luxemburg is actually looking at, you know, saying the same thing that John Maynard Keynes said many years later, that actually there is a problem of demand in capitalism, that capitalism is a demand-constrained system. He also looks at the relationship of money in Rosa Luxemburg, and that is in her book, Introduction to Political Economy, where she actually comes up with a theory later used by many economists such as Moseley and, you know, Duncan Foley and many others, where she looks at money, like total money, as equivalent to total labor. So she's one of the first people to understand the role of money in capitalism, right? And, you know, that's essentially what she's saying, that capitalism is demand constrained. Let's get to the second part of Luxembourg's argument in terms of economics, which is in the accumulation of capital. If you guys haven't read it, you should. She says that there is a tendency of capitalist processes to go into spaces where capitalism hasn't gone before. What you see before you, this is a map of Algeria. And she narrates this very specific story of the Kabyle tribes. She says that, you know, when the French started occupying Algeria, one of the major things that they did was to take over the land in which the, you know, the tribal lands for these tribal groups, and force them to essentially, you know, have property norms. And that really messed up their way of provisioning themselves. They could no longer now take their cattle to graze in long distances. Rather, they were forced to graze the cattle in their own lands, which caused soil erosion because the, you know, cattle are grazing in that very same land and not giving that time for the soil to replenish itself. And that really caused a devastation of the area, the green area that you see on this map here. I mean, this map is a much more recent map, so you can imagine that the green area was actually much larger than what it appears in this map, right? So there is a tendency towards primitive accumulation, towards the foisting of capitalist relationships in spaces that are not capital. Particularly, Luxembourg is looking at colonization. And that actually makes Luxembourg very much, very popular with people who are against colonization or who are still trying to critique and understand colonization today. Another example that she gives in her book is, you know, forcing the Chinese to sell opium, I mean, or to buy opium, which is something that the British ensured through the Opium Wars, where they fought against the Chinese Empire when the Chinese Empire said that we don't want your, you know, imports of opium from the Bengal plains in India, right? So that was another one, you know, forcing people to consume products when they don't want to consume those products through violence. War as a way of primitive accumulation, you know, capitalism is undergoing crisis. Well, you got to fund your army, you got to increase defense spending, and that, you know, keeps the cycle of capitalism going and keeps the profits of companies high, right? Then there's finance. Finance ensures, and you know, there are many Rosa Luxemburg commentators like Jan Taporowski who talk about Rosa Luxemburg's understanding of finance as anticipating Hyman Minsky's idea of finance. The idea that finance leads to instability rather than stability, unlike what many scholars such as Lenin used to think. So finance, you know, where you've taken a loan and now you have to pay the loan back, so you have to sell your property to capitalism, or you have to necessarily go into the labor market early. Don't go do a PhD, don't go do a master's, get a job immediately because you have to pay off your student loans. You know, these are ways in which loans push people to get into the capitalist workforce, right? So these are all ways of primitive accumulation that Rosa Luxemburg sees in her book. And then, of course, I mean, I've finished this very quickly in 35 minutes. Rosa Luxemburg, what are the lessons that we can learn from Rosa Luxemburg's work? Primarily that, you know, we need to start to think of capitalist incursions as not just into land or labor, but we also need to look at other aspects such as unpaid labor. You know, how does capitalist incursions occur in unpaid labor? By trapping mostly women workers, unpaid workers, into this relationship with vis-a-vis capital, whereby, you know, when wages tend to go high, then more and more women are joining the labor force. Labor force participation goes up and wages end up getting stabilized, right? And at the same time, you know, as soon as the recession hits, women are thrown out of the labor force, or the idea that that your participation in productive activity is more important than any other kind of participation. The kind of forced hysterectomies that have happened in Haryana, for example, where migrant women come in and, they participate in agricultural work, but their employers are very worried that they'll get pregnant, so they have to go and get hysterectomies, right? So, you know, the idea of capitalism and how it impacts women's labor and women's bodies, this is something that follows directly from Rosa Luxemburg's theory, and this was under-theorized in Luxembourg. Then the other things that we need to learn when we talk about primitive accumulation, we need to talk about the role of money in capitalism, the role of finance, the idea of war. We need to talk about private takeovers of public property. And of course, as activists, the most important thing to really remember is that, you know, being part of a people's movement should liberate you. True freedom is for the person who thinks differently. So in every organization, whenever you have that one person who thinks differently from the rest of the nation, you need to give that person space to be able to articulate views that are contrary from the collective. I'll stop there, Swati. Over to you. I can't hear you.
Mute, Swati.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Comrade Rushira. I loved how you said Rosa was someone who wanted to live for revolution rather than die for leadership. Someone to raise a child, and how you connected your neighbor with motherhood. And she was someone who believed personal and political can never be separated. And to be a revolutionary is to live a fulfilling life as well as to strive for building up a better world where there's less oppression. Well, now, without any delay, we would like to move forward to the second part of this public meeting where I'll be reading out your questions and Professor Ruchira shall be addressing it. You can place all of your questions in the comment section. Now, please give me a minute. The first question says, could you please recommend books that will be good introduction to Rosa Luxemburg's life and work?
Should I do that now? Okay, here's one. I don't know if you can see this. This says The Complete Works of Rosa Luxemburg. It's edited by Peter Hudis. Only volume one is out, which is on economic writings. And if you look at the table of contents, you know, you can also get these separately. You don't have to get this on the Peter Hudis volume. So you have her thesis, her PhD essentially, called The Industrial Development of Poland. She has a critique of Adam Smith called Back to Adam Smith. There's the Introduction to Political Economy. And you know, you will get most of these on Marxist.org. So you don't have to buy this book. Then, of course, you guys really do need to read The Accumulation of Capital. It's on Marxist.org. Don't even trouble yourself about buying the book. The only reason why I own a book is because a professor of mine who passed away gave it to me when he got cancer and was about to pass away. Professor Fred Lee. I should mention him, right? Read Rosa Luxemburg's economic writings. Peter Hudis has a very nice introduction of her. So does Paul Zaremka, which you will get online, because he writes for open access journals. You know, these are people who, really believe that the personal is political, right? So they write for open access journals. And read some of Rosa Luxemburg's own work, Accumulation of Capital, The Anti-Critique, Introduction to Political Economy. And these three should get you going for now, right?
Okay. Someone has commented, love how you said children raised by mother with their labor and not use the words like love and affection.
It was interesting actually, because most children are still raised by mothers and not so much so by fathers. And if it's not mothers, it will be female figures, you know, where essentially what has happened, and there are feminist economists that you guys might want to read, like Julie Nelson and Nancy Folby, who essentially talk about how a large part of women's work is essentially just about reproducing the system, you know, whether it's the capitalist system or not, but just reproducing the system as it is. And men's work typically becomes about profit-making work, whereas women's work becomes essentially subsistence work. And raising a child is subsistence work. You know, you are creating the labor power of society, which will later go on into producing for society. And it's very unfortunate, but mothers still take on a bulk of it. Special note here to my partner, Shomodip Roy, who is looking after my son right now.
Okay, the next question is the idea of capitalism being self-destructing system?
Now that's a trick question. So, you know, this idea that Rosa Luxemburg has, it was critiqued many times. And I think one of the biggest holes in the argument, like the idea of underconsumption is a very famous idea and it was very easily broken down. Paul Sweezy first read Rosa Luxemburg as an underconsumptionist and he said, look, the idea is ridiculous because then you would just have a huge stockpile of goods which are sitting in the advanced countries and, you know, you would have, in that case, a need to push that mountain of goods to developing countries, and that does not happen, right? So that the idea of underconsumptionism was very easily destroyed. But that view, you know, many Luxemburg commentators ended up, you know, saying that, look, Rosa Luxemburg wasn't saying that. She was saying that capitalism is a demand constraint system, which is certainly true, you know, because you do see crises after crises in capitalism, with most famously the 2008 crisis, the year I came to JNU, where, you know, capitalism was in crisis, subprime crisis happened, you know, it became very difficult to find a job. Today we're in a crisis, post-COVID crisis, and we need government stimulus to recover. That being said, there are always methods by which capitalism manages to recover from crisis, primarily the state, right? Because, you know, the state ends up spending and boosting demand. The other way is technology. And that is something that Luxemburg did not talk about. And that is actually the biggest hole in the argument that, and then I think if you truly, and this is an open area for those of you who want to do a PhD, if you truly want to theorize whether capitalism will self-destruct, one needs to be able to bring in technological progress into Luxembourg's argument to say, to be able to understand how, technological progress can save capitalism, but not necessarily, and when does it not? So that's an under-theorized and a open area for those of you who want to do a PhD. It's a good place. Okay, don't do a PhD on it. You won't get a job if you do a PhD on that, warning. But if you need a research project to devote your life to, that's a good one.
Okay, the next question says, what are the similarities and difference between ideas of feminists in modern India, modern Indian history and ideas of Rosa's?
By feminists in modern Indian history, what do you mean? Are you thinking Savitribai Phule?
Probably. Savitribai Phule, Fatima Sheikh.
That's a nice one. Well, I haven't read anything, similarities, or that would be a very interesting thing to look at to try and see how, you know, what would be connections between Luxembourgist ideas and Savitribai's ideas. At one level, you do have two public figures that really lived their politics and, you know, took it very seriously that your life has to be an example of the kind of society that you want to build. So, you know, you do see that. You know, you believe that the aim of education is to liberate society. You need to get out there and start educating young Dalit girls and, you know, and do it. Of course, you know, you don't see much engagement with caste in Luxembourg. She mentions Indian Brahmin society at one point, but mostly with respect to British rule. So you might not see very many similarities between Luxembourg and modern Indian feminists, but you do see similarities between Luxembourg and second wave feminism. The idea of incursions upon the body, the idea of the body as a space where capitalism hasn't quite taken over it, and how does capitalism try to take over women's labor and women's bodies? How does rape become a tool of capitalist incursions? And you know, you would see that you know, say a lot of leftist critique of rape in the Nirbhaya agitation. You know, say the critiques of Soni Sori, you know, I mean, not the critics of Soni Sori, but rather the ideas of, you know, what was the Indian state trying to do to Soni Sori? That's an idea that Luxembourg would be, you know, that would come out of Luxembourg's theory as well.
The next question says, Rosa Luxemburg's death occurred in mysterious circumstances. Can it be viewed as a patriarchal silencing of women over the political sphere?
Of course, yes. Death is the ultimate way to silence a person. I don't know if you guys have read this one. It's a really nice book by Rebecca Solnit, which says, Men Explain Things to Me. It's mostly about mansplaining. Yeah. But this is one thing that she highlights, the idea of death as the ultimate way to silence. And, you know, it happened to Rosa Luxemburg. It has happened to Gauri Lankesh. It has happened to many others. I believe the scam on Nidhi Rajdan perhaps might have been a way to silence a woman there, right?
Questions, I'm sorry. The question says, what can the left today, Rosa Luxemburg's analysis of the Russian Revolution, especially regarding her critique of authoritarianism and ideas on the question of nationalities?
Well, most importantly, that's a very good question. What can the left learn? First of all, the idea of the working classes international. And secondly, you know, the idea that it needs to create spaces of dissent. You can't throw out groups when they dissent against Politburo's opinion. Right? And, you know, you need to create space for that. Create space for that organizational institution.
The next question says, did her economic work represent her political and revolutionary views?
Absolutely. One flows from the other. So the idea that capitalism is a demand-constrained system, it's unstable, means that, you know, you can't rely upon, you can't say, okay, capitalism is here, deal with it, let's just, you know, concentrate on the trade union movement. Because capitalism is unstable, you can't do that. It means then you have to do other things. And because then she also believes that there is a tendency for incursions of capitalism into non-capital, then that means that those incursions have to continuously be resisted throughout, you know. Anti-capitalist struggle means resisting those capitalist incursions. And that means, you know, you support the fights of the tribals, you support the struggles of students, you support the struggle of working women, of women, and so on and so forth.
We'll be taking two more questions and then we'll end it. Recently, there was a debate on whether homemakers should be paid for their labor. Could this encourage patriarchs in dissuading women from going out for work or getting them educated?
Well, I definitely read an op-ed piece on that by Sunny Jose, if you have, I saw that one in The Hindu, and it argued along this line. I thought Sunny Jose did a very good job in that op-ed, where he said that, you know, paying women for their labor, and I believe they should be, recognizes women's work, but it doesn't do one thing. It doesn't redistribute women's work. So it's not a policy which does everything. And there is a need for a wider debate around redistribution of women's work.
Yeah. The last question. David Harvey has changed his position and now says that imperialism is more a category that that helps much in explaining the world. However, Rosa Luxemburg has insisted that imperialism is essential for capitalism. What's your take on that?
I agree with Rosa Luxemburg on this, that imperialism is essential for capitalism. But, you know, one has to reimagine how this imperialism is occurring. I am not commenting on Harvey at the moment because I'm still working on trying to, you know, understand what he's saying. But we need to reimagine how imperialism takes place. You know, for a lot of people, they say, okay, now the whole world is capitalist now and it hasn't collapsed, so Rosa Luxemburg is wrong. But is the whole world capitalist? Sure, you have most countries are bourgeois in some way, even if they're not democracies. But there are a lot of spaces where the logic of sustenance is different from the logic of capitalism, like households, like several institutions, higher education institutions, institutions for, you know, reproducing the arts. Media is, of course, capitalist, but there are some non-profit, you know, media, for example, ProPublica in the United States, which is about foregrounding the voices of people. You have the People's Archive of Rural India. So, you know, there are a lot of non-capitalist spaces that are constantly being developed as an opposition towards capitalism. And a large part of resisting capitalism is to protect these spaces and to continuously create new spaces. So essentially, imperialism is essential to capitalism, and the fight against imperialism is essential to anti-capitalism.
Well, I must say it was indeed a very insightful talk, and we'll end this here. Thank you so much, Professor Ruchira, for sparing your time and joining us today. We are so very glad to have you with us. And on behalf of Democratic Students Federation, I would like to thank all our viewers for joining in and making this interactive session possible. I hope Comrade Rosa continues to be our guiding light in our struggle, and we can all continue imagining and rebuilding a revolutionary socialist and egalitarian world of our dreams. With this, I would like to conclude this public meeting. In coming days also, we'll definitely be organizing more such public meetings and talks. And for keeping up with us all and for all the updates, don't forget to follow and subscribe to our YouTube channel and other social media handles. All the relevant details will be provided below. And once again, thank you, good night, and red salute to all of you.